Thank you, everybody. That is almost as fun as I think the Six musical at Kentucky Performing Arts this week is going to be. So if you don't have tickets, try to get them. Talk to Kim. Thank you, Cynthia, for that very warm welcome. She said no. Sorry, there's no tickets. Sold out. thank you for that very warm welcome. As Cynthia mentioned, JP Morgan has been honored to be the presenting sponsor of this series for 7 years, but this series has been in existence for 18 years. We know at JP Morgan that enabling women to be better connected enables you to be better professionals. We invest in our own people and in the companies and the communities that we support, and we're really excited to be here today. So in addition to the lovely Kim Baker, the reason this event is called 100 Wise Women is because we invite women at your tables to act as table hosts. And so you can see some of the names up here on this slide. I would also ask anybody who is acting as a table host today to please stand and be recognized. These women are going to help lead our conversations today. So thank you so much for your participation. I know you're going to have a wonderful time today, and it is now my pleasure to introduce a new friend, Molly Ricketts, CEO of Incipio Workforce Solutions, who will introduce our keynote speaker today.
Good morning. Happy Wednesday. What a beautiful group of people this morning, and all I can say is it's just terrible outside, and we still showed up. We still look great, and we are here and present, so give yourself a round of applause. At Incipio, we partner with organizations throughout the Bluegrass and across the state and more. One of the things that we pride ourselves on is working with organizations to assist them in making better hiring decisions. How do we do that? We do so by ensuring and protecting that we're protecting and promoting their sense of community within their organization and helping them cultivate a culture of growth and success. Just like 100 Wise Women, the lineup for this year's speakers is amazing, and bringing and shining light onto the top tier talent that we have within the community, especially within women business leaders. Good job, thank you. So, now it's my honor to introduce Kim Baker. What a really cool experience I had a couple of weeks ago in having the opportunity to speak with her directly and learn more about her as a person. But the impact that she's had in the community through KPA, Kentucky Performing Arts, is even better. Kim is in her 10th year as president and CEO of Kentucky Performing Arts and is the first woman and first Kentuckian to serve in that capacity. Congratulations, that's awesome. She has a lifelong passion for the arts, which we'll soon learn more about. Under her leadership, Kentucky Performing Arts has expanded to a family of venues that includes the Kentucky Performing Arts on Main Street, the acquisition of the historic Brown Theater on Broadway, and the development and construction of the Old Foresters Paris Town Hall, which is a really cool place. Love that spot. She's received numerous honors, and why wouldn't she? She's connected as a national leader in the performing arts, representing Kentucky Performing Arts as a member of the Broadway League and the Performing Arts Consortium. Locally, she's a board member of the Muhammad Ali Center and is vice chair for Kentucky Performing Arts Foundation Board of Directors. She served as a chair for the Arts and Cultural Alliance and was on the steering committee for the Imagine 2020. The region's arts and cultural master plan. Kim is a graduate of Leadership Louisville and Bingham Fellows, and that is a lot of work, but it's worth it, and is committed to helping her community move through the arts. She's married to prosecutor Mark Baker and has three daughters who remind her every day that there's nothing more interesting and or important than the drama of real life. Kim Baker.
Not to waste my life. She said, spread your wings, my little butterfly. Don't let what they say keep you up at night. And if they give you
I'm walking really slow because Nick Hovalt recommended this incredible song, and I just wanted to hear it a little bit longer. All right. Welcome, everybody. Good morning. It is really great to be here this morning with you. And I am, first of all, I'm so excited because this is a sellout. This is a sellout. And for someone who spent her whole life selling tickets, I only had to buy, 25% of them, but it's a sellout. But it's very humbling. I've spent my life telling other people's stories. So to be up here telling my own story is really very challenging. I have to say, I didn't realize how hard it would be. It's been the hardest story to tell, but I'm surrounded by those who I know love me and support me. And that includes my wonderful family. I've got my husband, Mark, here. My daughters, Olivia, Samantha, and Georgia. My brother, Doug, and his husband, Patrick. My best friend, Laura, who drove in from college, but she drove in all the way from, I almost said Hopkinsville. Liz did not drive here. From Somerset. And many dear friends and colleagues. I have board members, including a former wise woman, Madeline Abramson, who is a past chair of the center board, and my board chair here, I know, whoop, whoop. My board chair here, Greg Buballo, who I have finally been able to say his name correctly. And then there's so many others from my life. I am really surprised by all the people that have come here for me today to support me, and you have been a support all through my life. I also want to recognize the men that are here today because, Jeremy, Cam, there's a handful of you all. And I just have to say, I'm going to be talking a lot about wise women, but if you're here, you're in the club. So so if I'm talking about them, I'm talking about you too. I want to thank the team at Leadership Louisville, certainly, for the great work that they do and for the sponsors that make programs like this possible. Sponsors are so important as well, to the center, to our nonprofit Performing Arts Center. And, I've come here over the years since I was really a young professional, and I've always left very inspired. I just realized I saw what other wise women? I remember I was just thinking about one of my earliest ones when I saw Sandra Fraser do her wise woman speech. Are there other wise women in the audience? Just for a second. I don't want to leave anyone out, like if Carolyn Tandy's here or something. Okay. All right. Well, let's give them a round of applause, too. Past wise women. There you go. Okay. Well, I am very honored, because as women, I think we've probably already done 100 things this morning, and you're here for me this morning, so I'll get on with it. One of my favorite images is the visual that pops up that says, Ginger Rogers did everything that Fred Astaire did, but she did it dancing backwards in high heels. Isn't that the truth? As women, we tend to do it all. Sometimes we glide across the stage effortlessly, and sometimes our high heel breaks, and we end up on a pile on the floor. But we dust off our little black dress, and we take off our high heels, who needs them anyway, and we continue the dance. It's the art of being a woman. I'm an arts professional, as you'll see. It's been ingrained in my psyche as long as I've lived. The arts fill our souls with so much, and they're really chock full of life lessons every day. When we think of our lives from an arts perspective, I'm going to pull up your memory banks to high school English now and think of life as a three-act play. It's an ancient dramatic principle traced back to Aristotle's Poetics, where he defines the three acts and says each act must be bridged by a beat or episode that sends the narrative into a different direction. There's the first act, the setup, the story begins, and the foundations are laid. The second act is the confrontation. This is where the action happens, the story builds to a climax or struggle or pivotal moment. And the third act is where the story finds its conclusions, its results, its meaning. My first act begins appropriately surrounded by strong women. My mother, Anne, was born in 1933, and she grew up on a farm in Bloomfield, Kentucky. And when she graduated from high school, she went to secretarial school. It's so funny to hear it called secretarial school now. She graduated and began working at an interior and commercial design firm, and that's where she met my father, who was selling paint. And though it's unclear if my father landed the account, he did land my mother. They married, and together they had three children, and I was the youngest and the only girl. Growing up, I called two places home because every weekend we would drive back to my grandma's farm, and there was a definite cadence to my week. My grandfather, having died at a young age, left my grandma to run the farm by herself, and I watched as she took care of tobacco and livestock. She was really the CEO of her time. She ran the farm and the family with grace and power. And spending that time with my grandmother taught me many important life lessons. They were small, but together they made a really big impact on my core values. Things like be on time for church, wear an apron to keep your good clothes clean, tend your garden before the sun comes up, and very importantly, save your change. It all adds up. Many small habits in the seemingly simple way she lived her life taught me about commitment, hard work, respect, not being wasteful, and the beauty of routine and our natural environment. I also learned the joy of creativity, because at the farm, there were none of the distractions that people face today. Nurture nourished my imagination and gave me the space to explore creatively. So my brothers and I played outside all the time. We baked mud pies, caught lightning bugs, and looked for artifacts from times gone by, like arrowheads, old pottery, and other heirlooms in the soil. It was an education of the most natural and welcome sort. I also shared a bond with my great aunts, Georgie and Mary. Georgie was fun and adventurous. Mary was pragmatic and no nonsense, but both were teachers of life. One of the greatest and most memorable lessons I ever learned was from my great aunt Georgie, and it's one of my earliest memories. One day as a child, my brother Doug and I spent an afternoon at Big Rock Park. It was a beautiful day, and I remember my brother making it to the top of the big rock. I was begging to get in the water, but Georgie always kept me close. I looked out into the stream, and I could see all these happy people, and they were playing in the water, laughing and splashing, and enjoying their day. I continued to beg her to let me get wet, and finally she relented and said, "Okay, you can get in and get your toes wet, but don't get your undies wet, and don't talk to the hippies." She stripped me down to my t-shirt and underwear, and off I went. Well, when in the water, I saw the hippies waving me to come closer and smiling. And I remember this so clearly, and I had to be a toddler. I looked back at Georgie, and then I went bounding towards them. But my toe hit a rock, and I fell. Well, of course, I got wet from head to toe, and I stood there crying until Aunt Georgie came and rescued me. Now, one would think that the lesson I learned from that might have been to listen to those that know better than you, but that's not it. I've later come to see it as a metaphor that makes me smile. We all need to get our toes wet in the adventures we seek, but it's always wise to have a big picture and be aware of the things that can cause you to trip. I needed to remember that because although I've shared with you all this idyllic, you know, childhood that I had, back at home during the week, I lived a very different life. Every family has its skeletons in the closet, and ours was my father's alcoholism and all that brings with it. He was a very kind man, but he was on and off the wagon, and his alcoholism was the proverbial elephant in the room. It was something we really never discussed as a family. The impact of the disease on our family was clear, and I saw a mother who was always stressed and carried the weight of raising the children and making the ends meet. My mother did everything she could to give us a happy and normal life, including getting support from my grandma and my great aunts. And for this reason, my brother and I didn't miss out on the things that other kids did. She kept us busy, and she shared with me later that taking us to my grandmother's farm every weekend was her way of keeping us out of trouble. But what it really did was it kept us away from the chaos that came with my father. Keeping us active did something else, though. It taught us to try new things and develop our creativity. We all had several extracurricular interests, and for me, it was music, dance, and figure skating. The arts were an escape for me. We loved going to the movies and plays, and I really loved the musicals. And I remember, you know, I knew all the words to Fanny Bryce and Funny Girl and Eliza from My Fair Lady. Those experiences with my mother, they really broadened my horizons and they nourished my dreams. I began playing flute when I was 10 years old, and I discovered my love of making music. Playing an instrument was transformative for me. It not only pulled at my emotions in the way only music can, but it also kept me focused on improving, led to the development of friendships, and taught me important lessons about teamwork and responsibility. My mother constantly encouraged me to seek out opportunities and put myself out there. So I auditioned and I participated in everything that I could. I had found something that I enjoyed and was good at, and I learned how great it feels to put work into something and excel. I'm sure I'm remembering high school through rose-colored glasses. I have some friends from high school, Beth and Tiffany back there, I didn't expect to see today. But it seems high school for me was like every 80s coming-of-age movie you've ever seen. And I found a group of incredible friends, and we learned many life lessons together. I experienced the magic of first love and the pain of first heartbreak. I continued to get more serious about music and found myself regularly in the top seats in statewide competitions. And my senior year, I auditioned for a program that was introduced as the first of its kind, a new program called the Governor's School for the Arts. Whoop, whoop. And then, you know, someone that I actually attended is here. So Kathy's out here in the audience, and she's a flute player with me. I can't remember her married name, so wave your hand, Kathy. Okay, there you are. All right. This tuition-free program was designed to gather young artists from across the Commonwealth for a conservatory-style intensive. But at the audition, I remember walking out on the Whitney Hall stage at the Kentucky Center, oddly enough, as a 16-year-old, and my heart was pounding, my legs were shaking, and I was absolutely terrified. But I was accepted, along with 100 artists from across the state to participate in the very first year of this program. Going to GSA did three very important things for me. First, it exposed me to a variety of art forms and instructors who raised the bar. They were teaching at professional levels and collegiate levels, and you know, I actually even had an opportunity to work with renowned artists like James Galway. Second, it thrust me onto a campus of young Kentucky artists just as talented, enthusiastic, and curious as I was. I was inspired every day. Thirdly, it cemented for me that I had found my place and that I would create a life and a career surrounded by artists. Also, I met this woman. For those of you who don't recognize this picture, that's Governor Martha Lynn Collins. Collins was the first female governor of Kentucky, and it was under her administration that the Governor's School for the Arts began. Governor Collins visited the program frequently, and I realize now she was probably the first professional woman leader I had ever seen in person. It's very important for us to have role models. She continued to connect with that program and with the graduates in the years ahead. In fact, I played at the governor's mansion several times at her invitation, which was really a very special experience for anyone, much less a 16-year-old. Then on a college visit, I met another woman who would impact my future. When I was auditioning for colleges, I found myself at the University of Kentucky, go Cats, learning about a new field of study they were offering that combines business and the arts. We were joined by a woman named Holly Salisbury, who was speaking to prospective students about the business behind the arts. And a light bulb went in my head, and my mother leaned over to me and said, maybe that's the kind of thing you can do one day. And that's how I found my way to my life's work. It was time to get my toes wet. So here we are at Act Two with the foundation laid. Taking the lessons I had learned in childhood to heart, I found that college was a bit like a dream. I think it was like a dream. It could have been other things. Felt like just as soon as it began, it was over. I studied business and the arts at the University of Kentucky. I marched in the Wildcat marching band during football season and performed with the orchestra when the season was over. And I worked a variety of jobs. I worked all the time. I taught music lessons and summer band camps and played wedding gigs. I was a music librarian, box office manager, hostess, and waitress. This, along with the letters my grandmother would send me, always with a $20 bill or two tucked inside, got me through, and I graduated college debt-free. Now, having three girls that are getting ready to go to college, the idea of graduating debt-free is pretty powerful. I joined Kap Alpha Theta Sorority, which kept me connected to an entirely different group of women, and these sisters continue to be some of my best friends today. I also continued to nurture my love of the performing arts, and one spring break, when many of my friends were headed to the beach, I took off with a few of my sisters for New York and saw my first musical on Broadway, which is a very different experience, Les Mis. And this was my first time in New York, and from the shock of seeing the skyline driving into the city to the power of the performance on Broadway, I was hooked, and I knew New York was where I really wanted to be. I graduated in the summer of 92 from college and came back to Louisville, though just to save money and make my way back to New York. A few months later, I was hired at Kentucky Performing Arts. I went in for a job in the box office, but they saw me come in and they said, actually, there's a full-time job in another area called programming. I didn't know what programming was. I thought, is that with computers? I have no idea. But I found out that programming was actually the heartbeat of the center and the place where all of the artists were curated. So I was able to bring in and work in the area that brought in some of the greatest artists of all times. Artists like Wynton Marsalis, Itzhak Perlman, Ray Charles, Baryshnikov. I experienced some of the world's most prestigious companies like Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater and the Joffrey. Interested in learning more about the industry, I moved to another venue, the Louisville Gardens, experiencing learning about producing and promoting even more great shows and artists. And I met artists like Barry Manilow, Dolly Parton, Prince, Tom Petty, Bernadette Peters, we did wrestling, Sandra, and countless others. Not bad for a girl out of college. I'm often asked who my favorite artist is, and I always get this look of astonishment when I tell them it's Lyle Lovett. I fangirl a bit over Lyle. And I get exactly what Julia Roberts sees in him, because I love his songs, or saw in him. I love his songs and his stories, but when you meet him, he's so kind and humble and almost shy, it's really very disarming. As I learned more about the Louisville arts community, dreams of moving to New York really began to fade, and I was hooked on what an established art scene was right here in my own backyard, and began driven by giving back to the place that had given so much to me. Plus, I found that in my job, I got to travel all over the place, to New York, LA, the West Coast, all over, to scout talent and keep abreast of the industry. And so how cool is that? I continued to seek new experiences and move up in my career, and I ended up managing the theater at Iroquois and the Historic Brown Theater, all the while being part of a field that is dynamic and creative. My personal life kept me even more grounded to Louisville. I met my husband Mark and married in my early 30s. Olivia, our first child, came 2 years after. Then came Samantha and Georgia May. I couldn't have asked for anything more. And though life was wonderful, I was busy. When Georgia was just a baby, a little over a year old, I went in for a physical and my doctor discovered a lump in my breast. My doctor told me not to worry, that they would run tests. I remember when I received the news, I went to the backyard and I just stood there, taking in what I was hearing. The test results came back and told me what I knew in my heart, that I had cancer and that it was spreading. I was numb and my mind was spinning from extremes of what might happen. Don't we do that sometimes as women? Our mind goes to all the different kind of extremes. But I just remember standing there like a statue thinking. I don't remember crying, but I do remember feeling incredible guilt and really regret, because a year earlier, I had actually felt that same lump, though it was much smaller, and I dismissed it because I was breastfeeding. But in the whirlwind of life, I wasn't taking care of myself. I was focused on everything but me. I took a moment to be a little crazy, thinking about all the tragic outcomes that could lie ahead of me. And then I got busy getting through it and getting better. After talking to friends and seeking as much information as I could, so there I was again, just to remind you, I was assessing the landscape. I knew that I was going to go through something incredibly tough and that to get through it, I would have to let others be a part of my mess. I prepared for the difficult times ahead. When friends and colleagues of Mark and I asked how they could help, we let them. Friends set up a meal train to keep food coming so we didn't have to worry about cooking. I had a one-year-old, one in kindergarten, and another in first grade, so we also set up a childcare calendar for my children, and friends and colleagues signed up to take the girls on adventures so I could focus on my health and work. Seriously, I was going through the worst time of my life, and my kids were having, I think, the best time of their life. But they were just too young to understand. I believe that letting people in to help was really, really critical to my healing. It kept me going, and it kept my spirits high. I think sometimes we think it's easier to go it all on our own, but we fail to realize how much we really need others. This is a lesson that's proven true for me time and time again, and you'll see another example of that in just a moment. As a mother of infants three times over, I thought I knew tired, but I had never experienced anything like chemo tired until I experienced COVID tired. I tolerated the treatment and continued to work full time until that very end of the treatment. And once the chemo was finished, I had a double mastectomy. The result was all that I could have hoped for, and I will be 12 years out in May.
Yay.
Well, three things kept me going through that time in my life. My family, my friends, and really my work community was critical. It was about the people in my life that got me through. I returned to work grateful for the support of my team, and I was committed to making sure I would take care of my health this time. I would find time for me. I would not carry so much stress. And then, a year after I returned to work, the Kentucky Performing Arts president position opened. So I had to decide whether I should apply on the heels of my remission. Not only would the application process be difficult, but the job would be difficult. Running a large nonprofit culture institution is a huge responsibility with all that it entails. In the day, you have to run the business, and in the evening, when shows and events are happening, you often need to have a presence there. It's both externally and internally focused. And we have one of the most dynamic cultural centers in the nation. Right here in Louisville. I mean, in an average year, we could put on as many as 300 events easily, and that doesn't count all that we do out in the community. I had worked under four different presidents and had learned a thing or two about the job. I learned from good leadership, and I learned even more from not so good leadership. I spent many years being part of witnessing actions from leaders and how those actions, both good and bad, impact those around you and the business. There's a great deal to learn there. And although sometimes it's darn near impossible to create change in others, you can at least model the change that you seek. And so that's when I decided it was time to try. So with enthusiasm and commitment, I went running into the water. And this time my eyes were wide open and I was bound and determined not to trip. At the end of a 6-month national search, I made it to the final interview. So here we are at Act 3, with the foundation laid in Act 1. Act 2 had some action, and I learned more good lessons like always assess the landscape for things that might make you trip, and don't forget to assess yourself and your health. I did get the position, and I became the first woman and the first Kentuckian to be the president of Kentucky Performing Arts. I was in my early 30s, and I was also the youngest president of Kentucky Performing Arts. Things were going very well. We were bringing in more artists and impacting more people in the community than ever before. We had a new expansion plan, and that included the acquisition of the Brown Theater and the building of Old Forester's Paris Town Hall. And then in June of 2018, I was in San Francisco on a work trip. And from across the country, I received an urgent call from my assistant who said, "The fire alarms are going off, and this time it's not a drill." Look, I'm glad you all are laughing. Well, after I told him to get out of the building, I faced something I could never have imagined, and the Kentucky Center was on fire. I felt as helpless as I've ever felt. There was nothing I could do except get on the first plane home, fly back. I was connected with all of the news stories that were going on. They were being reported live. I was getting texts from all over the country. I knew that the building had been evacuated and that everyone was safe, so that was a relief. We had been going through a replacement of our roofs at the center. The fire had started during hot work on the final roof to be redone, the signature barrel vault, which is made of copper. Unfortunately for us, getting under the roof was very, very challenging for the firefighters because the temperature of the copper heated. It took hours to get the fire out with gallons of water just flooding the center. When the plane landed, I immediately stepped off the plane. It was late at night, and I went to the center. I remember I called my husband, and he's like, "There's nothing you can do there. Come on home." I think you were kind of mad at me for going down there, but I did. I went right down there. And I was met by my head of facilities, who walked me through the devastating damage. There was no power, everything was drenched with water, and there was this overwhelming stench of heavy smoke that filled the air. I remember just walking through after the aftermath and taking it all in. It's almost like what I experienced when I found out I had breast cancer. My mind kind of was going crazy to extremes, and then I just switched over to a very problem-solving state. Though at the time, I had no idea how this really big problem was going to get solved. The majority of the damage actually came from the water. The center has a significant and very rare collection of 20th century art and sculptures. And thankfully, those pieces have been covered in preparation for the roof replacement. That was good fortune, and they were protected from the fire, smoke, and water. I knew that we had many professional companies, like Leslie is here with the Louisville Ballet, and they were depending on us to be open for performances. It was not just the health and the livelihood of the center, but all of the cultural groups that call the center their home. I had no idea what to do. It was clear that the center would have to be closed for an undetermined amount of time. So what do when you have absolutely no idea what to do? You show up, you own what you know and what you don't know, and you again rely on others to help you. Who was in my toolbox? I assessed the landscape. My board and its chair. The chair just so happened to own an insurance company and actually said, "This is going to be difficult, but you're going to learn a lot from it." The state, they actually are the owners of the building. The staff, those individuals who were committed, as I was, to the organization, and the many partners in the community, other venues, the media, et cetera. You see, over the decades, the center had been in operation. I wasn't the only one that felt ownership of the place. I discovered that the center lives in the hearts and the minds of so many. I was not alone in this. In fact, I had more support than I ever could have imagined. The center reopened September 1st, 2.5 months later. The construction continued until final completion in November of 2019, nearly a year and a half later. During that time, we were under major construction. Crews came in at 6 a.m. and they would break at 3 p.m. Then another crew of cleaners would come in and get everything cleaned up so that we could be ready for our audiences. The venue became a fully operating theater and at the same time a construction zone. We ended up only canceling one Broadway show and continued to operate through the year of reconstruction and cleanup. Even in the dust, that deserves a round of applause. Yeah, thanks. It really does. After the fire, I thought I could handle anything that life threw at me. There was just the slightest moment to take a deep breath and feel confident again. After finally announcing that construction was complete in November of 2019, we enjoyed a few months before the COVID shutdown of March 2020. Well, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on COVID because we all went through that. But let's just say I wasn't prepared for that. But I was more prepared than I would have been. All right, during this time, I also lost my beloved mother. The building's closure, though, did allow me to spend precious time with her at the end of her life. And she passed in July of 2021 and made it to her 88th birthday. I promised her I would see her off, and I did, and she was surrounded by her loving family, and I can say with a full heart that nothing was left unsaid. Though there have been challenges throughout my career, there are many more successes. I can honestly say that during my tenure, there have been record investments in our facilities. We've broadened our presenting to embrace new art forms and artists. I mean, we're talking everything from K-pop, Korean pop, to modern dance. And we've been able to double the numbers served through the Governor's School for the Arts. The center has increased access for under-resourced members of our community to experience the thrill of live performance. And we're mentoring young leaders on a local and national level. We've also become very connected with local and regional strategies to improve our community's quality of life. The arts are integral to our community's health. Yes, they are. Thank you. Of course, all of this would not have been possible without dedicated and talented board members, my staff members, volunteers, and the donors who deeply, deeply care about the mission. So, there are the three acts. But as an arts professional, I guess I have a little bit of a rebellious and creative side too. I'm going to add a fourth act, so my apologies to Aristotle. The encore. But first, what have I learned thus far? Always assess the landscape for things that might trip you up. Don't forget about assessing yourself and your health. Some fires are too big to put out on your own. You will be surprised at the help you will receive if you let people in. Never lose hope, because usually the story will have a happy ending. And one more thing, the most important thing I've learned thus far, recognize and lean on the wisdom of those around you and be a wise woman yourself. Along the way, I have had many women supporting me. Some of them are in the room with us today, women I have worked with, worked for, and women who cared for me or for the cause I was representing. Each of them bring a unique perspective to an equation. Together, they form a beautiful patchwork quilt. You'll remember the important women in my life, my first mentors and role models, my mother, grandmother, and great aunts who shaped who I would become. Later, there were people that I looked up to, role models like Governor Collins or Holly Salisbury, the leader and arts executive I met in college, and many others that I haven't named. These women are with me always, holding my very best interest at heart, reminding me to wade those waters, urging me to keep my eyes wide open and not to find myself underwater. I challenge you to think about those women in your life, the bigger-than-life characters, the unsung heroes, the ones who take your call at 3 a.m., the ones who don't judge or question. Think about them, and more importantly, lean on them. Those are the 100 wise women in our lives. May we all be those women, and may we pass the torch of wise and loving leadership to others in this room and beyond. As I exit now, stage left, I want you to remember there is no greater play than that of the real life. At times it'll be a drama, other times it'll be a comedy, and sadly, there will even be moments of tragedy. But regardless, make it yours and make it epic. Thank you.